Hi folks. I've been away for a week and I went north 100 miles to stay with my mom and give my sister a hand while her husband went to visit family for their family Christmas. I know it's before Christmas, but they all get together as a group. And that's 500 miles south, so my brother-in-law wasn't there to give my sister any assistance with the care of my mom. So I went up. I want to read something to you before I actually share with you what I'd like to share. It's found in Matthew chapter 24, and we begin at verse 42. It says, "Keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would not have let his house be broken into." This is reflective, you remember, of the parable of the 10 virgins. Five of them didn't keep watch properly, did they? They didn't pay attention. And when it came time to trim their lamps, they didn't have any oil. They'd run out of oil. You'll also notice that the other five virgins who did have lots of oil, they wouldn't share their oil with the other ones, for fear that there might not be enough for them. The oil in Scripture is understanding. It's figurative. Oil is figurative of understanding. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would have not have let his house be broken into. Remember earlier on, Jesus says he comes as a thief in the night. And many there be who miss their day of visitation. So you also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. Who then is the faithful and wise servant whom the master has put in charge of the servants in his household to give them their food at the proper time? Remember the table of the Lord. It's found in here. The manna from heaven that Jesus spoke of, the bread that's given by God, comes from here. It will be good for that servant whose master finds him doing so when he returns. Well and good. I tell you the truth, he will put him in charge of all his possessions. But, and this is what I want to really get into, but suppose that servant is wicked and says to himself, "My master is staying away a long time," and then begins to beat his fellow servants and to eat and drink with drunkards. The master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he is not aware of. He will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Let's not forget, that place where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth is the lake of fire. Let's also not forget that we're talking about here servants of God who are in charge. I tell you the truth, he will put him in charge of all his possessions. But suppose that servant of Jesus Christ is wicked and says to himself, "My master is staying away a long time," and he then begins to beat his fellow servants and to eat and drink with drunkards. You know what drunkards are, eh? They're the Slavians? What is it? Sabians. Sabians are the drunkards. It's those who want to... They want to drink, and they want to eat, but they don't want to do. Remember what a hypocrite is, eh? It's someone who doesn't practice what they preach. You remember faith, it's not just what we believe, but it's putting into action what we believe. So, I just want to tell you, as truthfully as I can, from the bottom of my heart, I'm not trying to beat on anybody. What I want to share with you today, I think is important for growth, for maturity. Is not me trying to beat on anybody. So I wanted to get that out before I even begin this video. So my mother's 93 years old. My sister and her husband are both God-fearing folks. I love them dearly. Couldn't ask for a better brother-in-law. He helps my sister with the care of my mom and stuff, lifting and stuff. But he has said that he's not young either. He must be 74. And it's getting too much for him. So I put in I made and installed a winch. I searched high and low and found a proper system, you might call it. It's a sling that attaches to the winch that a person is cradled in to lift them. And they don't use it a whole lot. So I thought, well, this opportunity to go north, I'll have a week to show my sister that how very valuable this sling can be, this winch. Whereas nobody has to lift, you know. Anyways, to try and keep my sanity while I was away, we all understand in a few minutes, I wrote everything. I wrote stuff down. I'm just going to read this to you in the hope that I've worded it properly on paper, that it can be grasped, it can be understood. I'm not pointing my finger at anybody, and I'm not complaining. I just think it's something that the church, they don't teach this kind of stuff in church. It's that simple. They don't teach it. I don't think they understand it themselves. There are quite a few of you folks who are older, and there are quite a few of you who are younger. Some of you, your children have been raised and gone. Many of you, your children are still with you. Some of you are single. But all of us, we talk to other people, we communicate. And to know these things and share these things with those around us doesn't just have to be family. It can be the neighbor. It can be the lady who comes over for a coffee. You know, it can be anybody that you know. And call a friend. And so, it's good to know and understand these things. I ask this question. Have you ever entered a place where the stench of rotting flesh overwhelms you? Ever been to a place like that? It is nauseating and can even cause a person to gag and vomit. We're talking a stench. In the literal, most of us can and do understand that experience. Whether it be a dead animal on the side of the road that's rotting and stinking and you stop and get a whiff of it, you know. Whether it be a slaughterhouse that hasn't been cleaned as often perhaps as it should. Even just the blood on the slaughter floor can really stink after a while. Maybe it's rotten eggs in the fridge and you crack an egg into your bowl and it's rotten and you get a whiff of it, you know. I think we all understand it in the literal. But in the spiritual, most are completely ignorant of what I'm talking about. So I'm going to explain it. I spent the last week 100 miles north at the home of my 93-year-old mother. My sister and her husband live with my mom, and my brother-in-law wanted to go south 500 miles to visit family and do a little deer hunting. So I came north to help my sister care for my mom while her husband was away. I don't know what the word is, seniorized my entire home. I have an elevator, I have lifts, I have jacuzzi bathtub, I have, all of the amenities you would need to care for an elder, but over the years it's been made plain I can't have mom. I would take care of her here if I could, but that's just not possible. Others won't allow it. My mom is an invalid. She cannot walk. She is rigid in the fetal position and is nearly deaf and nearly blind. When I arrived at her home, the air in the house was stagnant and quite warm. And after spending my first day caring for my mom, I will say to you what I said to my Wendy on the telephone that night. This house reeks of suffering and is heavy with the stench of sacrifices offered for no good reason. I hope that statement brings a few to recall statements in the Bible that are very similar. Now that may sound harsh considering I'm talking about my own mother's home, but let me explain. If what you do out of habit rather than with logical reason, and your habit causes pain to another person, is your offering of care given simply out of habit? Is it a worthy sacrifice? You know that we do offer sacrifices to God. No, it's not. It's a worthless sacrifice and a useless offering. For in spite of such an offering being offered in the name of love, it lacks logic. And in the absence of the knowledge of truth, causes or increases pain. Therefore, love is bastardized. It's twisted. It's perverted. For it is love in the absence of truth. Falsehood dwells in the absence of truth. And any care that falsehood gives hates. And does not love. Even when the one doing the care claims to love both God and the one they're caring for. If a person finds it painful to be lifted under the arms, and a caregiver refuses to use the available lift, and the cradle sling to move that person around, because it is less work for the caregiver to just grab them and lift them up, rather than to go to all the work to put them in the sling and everything and hook everything up and, you know, put a little pressure on it, you know, and tension on it, and then readjust it to make sure everything's right, not pinching any folds of skin or anything, and then lift them up, because it's easier to just put your arms under their your arms under their armpits and grab them and pull them up, and it causes pain. If a person finds it painful to be lifted from under her arms, and the caregiver refuses to use the available lift and cradle sling to lift that person, because it is less work for the caregiver to just lift the person from her arms, that caregiver may well be showing love in offering the care, but the truth says she's causing unnecessary pain, and the caregiver refuses to break her old habits of causing pain in order to relieve pain from the one they're caring for. You understand what's going on? That is not love. That is a sacrifice offered for no good reason other than serving the demands of the caregiver. It does not serve love for the one being cared for. It serves the demands of the caregiver. The caregiver is offering their care to an idol, and that idol is themselves. They refuse to change when the truth is presented to them, a better way to lessen pain, to lessen stress, and they refuse it. They're worshiping themselves. They're not worshiping God, who is love. United with truth. These are the ones the Father seeks, those who worship in spirit. The spirit of truth is love, and in truth. Or if you want to look at it from the other direction, those who worship in spirit and in love, because the spirit we serve, the God we serve, is truth. Truth and love. You can't take God apart. Some claim we don't offer sacrifices anymore. They claim that Jesus' sacrifice on the cross was the end of all sacrifice. And such people are so full of darkness, they're ignorant of God. They're ignorant of the truth. Darkness is ignorance. Why would I say that? Listen, 1 Peter 2 and 5. This is the New Testament. This is Peter, the apostle of Jesus Christ. You also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God.
We don't offer sacrifices anymore.
You're dumb as dirt. Firstly, a priest is to know and understand God's laws. Now, we've been over this. I ain't talking about women don't wear pants. I'm not talking about cutting all the fat off your beefsteak. I'm not talking about eating pork. I'm talking about God's laws. And all of God's laws are summed up in two commands. Love God and love your neighbor as yourself. Firstly, a priest is to know and understand God's laws. he or she is to have matured in the understanding of what God wants of us and how we are to offer what God wants of us. Not how we offer to self and what we want, but how we offer to God, who is truth. How we follow the truth. I'll give you some examples. A family's child has cut himself or herself badly. In fact, they've cut themselves so badly that they're bleeding out. They need a blood transfusion in order to survive. What sacrifice does Father Truth demand of that child's caregivers that child live? What does Father Truth demand? Doesn't take an imperial wizard to figure this out, does it? He demands a blood transfusion. That's the only thing that can save that little child. But what if a parent says, well, oh, but in our church, we don't agree with giving blood transfusions because we have an idea. Yeah, a false idea. Yeah. Remember what false ideas are, eh? Demons. Yeah. We don't believe in blood transfusions, so we just let the child die. Is that love? No. But to give the transfusion is a sacrifice given in love. Let's use another example. A child has scarlet fever and requires penicillin to abate death. What sacrifice does Father Truth demand of the child's parents? Get him some help. Give him some penicillin. You know, these penicillin, for example, if you ever read how penicillin was discovered, it would change your whole outlook. If you ever read how a CAT scan was, who invented the CAT scan and why he invented the CAT scan, he was a Christian trying to serve the body of Christ and help people. People say, it's against my religion to go to the hospital. They're all evil there. Who do you think gives wisdom? Who do you think teaches us how to preserve life? I would think Father Truth does, doesn't he? And he does it in an attitude of love. Are there people who pervert Father Truth's wisdom? Certainly there are. Certainly there are. Let's get another example. A vaccination can protect a child from contracting deadly disease. I don't think I have to explain all the different things that we've been vaccinated against. That those diseases don't even exist in our land anymore. What sacrifice does Father Truth demand of the child's caregiver? The truth comes. We know that polio vaccination will prevent your child from getting polio. I grew up with children and men who contracted polio when we were young. They didn't get vaccinated like I did. They were crippled. They suffered for the rest of their lives because their parents wouldn't vaccinate their children. What sacrifice does God demand? Oh, but I think. Well, I want to appear like I'm beating on anybody. I'm just trying to share. Does wisdom not come from God, who is truth, whose spirit is love? Is it love then to deny or pervert truth for for the sake of sacrificing to one's own personal perverted opinions and false ideas. Is that love? And the answer is no. That's not love. That's how the devil kills us. That's how he makes our lives miserable. Too many claim to be God-fearing Christians today, but they sacrifice only to themselves. They sacrifice only to what they think, rather than what the Word of God explains to them. My sister is like this. It is her way or the highway. Only she possesses wisdom in her mind. Only she knows what is right. As I said earlier, my mother's house reeks of suffering and is heavy with the stench of sacrifice for no good reason. There is a right way and a wrong way, and people who refuse to seek and walk the path of life now and in the hereafter. The path we walk now leads to the hereafter, doesn't it? Eh? We reap what we sow, don't we? Yeah. They offer only lies, pain, suffering, and death. To be truthful with everyone, I'm thoroughly disgusted with what the great whore, organized religion, has birthed. Her children are adulterers who climb into bed and copulate with falsehood the devil every time they want to play God over someone else. And they will not listen to reason nor test anything to see if it is of God or of the devil. My way with the lift for 6 days of the seventh, and Mom had no pain whatsoever. Period. I was going to say when she was being transferred from bed to toilet to chair, you know. I didn't even use the walker after the first day. I let my sister run the show for the first day, and I just paid attention to what was going on. And then I tried to tell her that, you know, this is really hurting Mom to have your husband and me lift her up like that from the under her arms. There's no need for it. We can use the lift and there'll be no pain. My mom loves that lift. She loves it. I hang her in it over her bed and sit there and swing her for 45 minutes. My dad always had a swing at home when we were kids, you know, big hydro poles up and across her and everything, like big swings, you know, and we loved them. My mom loved to swing. She still does. She could swing in the lift. It works great. She loved it. She enjoyed many an hour, me sitting there beside her bed swinging her, talking to her. My sister says it's a waste. My sister says leave the TV off. She can't see it anyways, and she can't hear it. She sees some. I tested her. She can see some. And she can hear some because she answers me when I talk to her. I put the TV on and she sits there and she pays attention for a while. Who cares if it's only 10 minutes? And then she falls asleep. Who cares? Who's it hurting? No one. But my sister's sitting out in the living room and she says, oh, I don't like the TV. It has to be loud when it's... I don't like it when I'm trying to read my novels. You call that love? That's not love. My sister won't listen to reason. I try to explain things and she just flies off the handle and says I'm not the nurse. My sister was, before she retired, was a registered nurse. I wasn't, I was a prison guard. So they won't listen to reason, nor do they test anything to see if it is from God or the devil. They think that they are all little gods. And the stench of their offerings makes me, even the likes of me, vomit. I don't like it.
I heard from God.
Bullshit. You heard your own perverted thoughts. Your thoughts are not God's thoughts, but God will share his thoughts with you. He'll share his thoughts with you if you pay attention. But no, they think that, oh, well, Jesus lives in me. Therefore, if I think it, it's the voice of God. Don't touch God's prophets. These lying sacks of shit aren't God's prophets. Period. They haven't got a clue of what's going on. They don't know, nor do they believe what's written in this book. Oh, they quote it over and over, but it's all out of context and in the literal, the wrong side of wisdom. They don't even believe in a spiritual side of wisdom. I end my letter with this. I end my video the same. Run for your lives, folks. Come out of her. Mystery Babylon. Organized religion. Get your heads on straight. Think before you speak. Ponder God's commands, his precepts, his parables, his riddles and his allegories. Ponder them. Before you start thinking that God is so pleased with your sacrifices and offerings, lest you find yourself cast out into utter darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jesus is Lord. Love one another. Lord willing, we'll see you again next week. Merry Christmas, by the way. God bless.